Morning church. Hope everybody's okay. Let's have a word of prayer, first of all, and give God the glory and the honor. Dear Father, dear Jesus, dear Lord, our time is yours, our resources, everything within us. Is yours. This time together is yours, and we want to lay down this time before you. We want to apologize you for our mistakes. I want to apologize you for my mistakes, for my stories, and that you can apply your blood, Jesus, in the church, in this congregation, and to you to apply your word with efficiency, Lord, through your spirit. Cancel my flesh, my mind, everything within me, and use me as a blessing. Please, Lord, in Jesus' name I pray, amen and amen. Amen. Taste and see. I preached this in the farm, but not as detailed as today. Taste and see. We have a deep problem in our days, which ends up being one of the main problems of Christianity. Is that we can go to church, we know God's way, God's ways, but we don't know God. Many preachers, they preach about this. I preach a lot about this. Maybe because of my position. Eventually, I'm one man looking to a group of people, a large group of people, with five houses or six houses. Where we all live in community, as we call community. But then you are a group of people looking at me. It might be easier for you to judge and to take the conclusions, either truth or not, because it's too much people looking at me. But me as an individual, of course, with the help of my wife, I look at each other and I look to the whole group of the congregation or the community. And I do understand daily that in many ways, in many people, we know God's ways, we know God's laws, we know what God wants, we know what the Word of God says, but we don't know what God, or no, we don't know God Himself. We know God's ways, but not God. But we are not able to taste God and to see His hand and His operative hand, a hand that is able to manifest His glory. Even that, many of us, we are not able to contemplate. And I always say to the people that the fruit that we bear will manifest our distance from the Lord. I never used an expression like this, but for those that know me the most, they know that I speak a lot about the fruit. So the fruit, it will reveal the distance you are from God, always. Because as much as we approach the cross of the Calvary, as much as we approach God, it will have to come a fruit. It will have to be manifested fruit, something. We have to bear fruit. And as much as we approach God, also one thing that's going to happen is that we will find out that we are not able to see God. Because also the Bible says that nobody saw God yet. I do believe deeply, it is not written in the Bible, but I believe, this is my beliefs, and then if I'm wrong, I think God is not going to burn me in hell because of that. But when I read the book of Genesis, I believe that God, that man, Adam and Eve, before their fall, I believe that they could see God, actually. But also their bodies weren't the bodies as we have now. The bodies were different. That's why then they found out they were naked, because out of the blue, suddenly, they could die. They lost their eternity. So they found themselves with a body like ours. But before, eventually, the body was totally different. They were totally different, and they were eternal. But this is just me when I read. Does it mean that now we have to take that as a doctrine? Doctrine is something that is in the Bible. It's visible and it's applicable, and it's proved. So, One of the things that we have to see without seeing God, it's its operative hand. A person that is not able to see the hand of God in his life or in our life, there is a huge problem in it. And I ask the assistants to see the people. There is a brother there sleeping. And so, please, Justin and Ezra, to be aware of the people. Thank you. So the operative end, we have to be entitled to see the hand of God. When we are not able to see the hand of God working, there is a problem with us. It's easier for us to spiritual speaking or emotionally speak about God and say that God is able to do. Another thing is that I'm able to say that God, beyond what is capable to do, he actually does it in my life. Because I tasted and I saw. I saw his glory in the manifestation of his glory and the manifestation of his compassion and the manifestation of his action. God can act. God can do stuff. God can manifest himself. Even with a society collapsing as is, financially, healthily speaking, because now the pandemic is a danger everywhere. It looks like that everybody's getting used to this thing of the pandemic, because actually we as humans, we have the tendency to get used to stuff, even to get used to our previous life. That's why many people, they don't recover of drugs. And speaking about this environment that we come, many of us, from drug addiction problems or alcoholic problems. You know why? Because we get used to the fact that we are like that. And then we just accept the way we are. And that's also a problem, because the Word of God says that we should not conform. The Bible says in Romans chapter 12, verse 2, we should not conform with this world, with the standards of the world, but we should renew our mind through the Word of God, through the concepts of God, in order for us to experiment either the good, pleasant, or the good will of God. We are entitled to not conform with this world. That means that we should not conform with ourselves. And in many cases, we conform with ourselves. We conform with our state. We conform the way we are. And guess what? We accept the condition we are. And we are not able to do nothing to change it. How do I change? Persisting. Many people think, how do I change? In our strength, if we see, we are not, we won't be able to do it. We won't be able to change. We need the help of God always. God is the agent of change in our lives. Yet, there is something that we can do. We can persist. Persistence is the key word for growth Christian, for the Christian, or the growth Christianity. It's persistent. People that have the ability to insist and to persist. I was speaking with Justin yesterday because of the book of Pastor Miguel Diaz, the founder of Rimar. And I said, who is reading the book of Untied those Donkeys, the little donkeys? Who was reading the book? And Justin said, I read the book, and now another person is reading the book. And then I asked Justin, so what do you think about the book? And he said, you know what? Pastor Miguel is a very persistent person. That's the word, né, Justin? Sure. Determined person, yeah. He's even better, the word determined, than persistent. He has determination. He does not quit. He insists. He hits in the same place until it's done. Why? Because once God speaks with you, and I believe this is the case of Pastor Miguel, once God speaks with him and says, this is the direction, this is what you have to do, he will insist. And some of us, we know Pastor Miguel personally, we know his character, we know that he is like that. He is determined to conclude everything that God places in his hand. Not in a prideful way, because he does not do it in his strength. Yet he can even preach that the tendency is there as any human being. He doesn't elevate himself as someone bigger or different. And that's why he is a servant he is. But in other hand, that's the key word for Christianity growth. It's persistent. We are determined to finish the work with God. God is the one that is working, but we are determined to say, I'm here, you will finish the work that once you start in my life. I won't quit. Once we come across with God's hand, we are not able to remain the same. Because then we will taste and we will see. It's impossible for a person that says that has a personal encounter with Jesus Christ or with God through Jesus Christ, it is impossible for you to remain the same. You can be in the church and you can become a religious person that come to church, have a Bible, has everything, dresses nicely, go every Sunday, go prayer meeting, pray. We even find strategic ways to pray. Many people, they have this prayer that is like a standard prayer. They pray the same prayer all the time. And of course, there is standard prayer we have. Everybody has. We don't change much the prayer of giving thanks for the food we are about to eat. Of course, we won't change much. There is not way of changing it. There is no different recipe. We can't put effort to change something that is as is. We are there to say thank you for the food. Thank you for the provision. But that we can develop that or format a standard prayer that then it looks like or it gives us the impression or give others the impression, because sometimes that's not the case, to give others the impression that we are mature in faith, that we have years with the Lord, and that eventually it looks like that is a position. This is not the army, my dear brother and my sister. The army is where I learned that I don't know, Carlos and me, I think we are the only ones here that went to the army, and Rui. So when we go to the army, they say that elderly, it's a position. Here is the same, Carlos, in South Africa. The oldest you are in the army, even if you don't have any higher graduation in the army, but just the fact that you have time in the army, that it makes you have a position in the army. Doesn't matter if you have a graduation or not. There is a sense of respect for that person because of the time. In the kingdom of God, there is no such thing of position. And sometimes we want to gain a certain position or a reputation. But we forget that the seeking of a reputation, it's something that is non-biblical. In fact, John the Baptist I always quote the scripture of John the Baptist that he says, it matters for me to go down, to shrink, to become less or lower in order for Christ to appear, in order for Christ to stand up and to stand visible and not me. So this thing of reputation that we want to create, even in Christianity, I'm telling you now, it's non-biblical. Reputation comes from God. God can give us a reputation that we should replace the word reputation, and we should place a word that many people in the church, they are not concerned about, they don't even care about, which is the word testimony. And then, as I was saying to somebody in the morning, that in the end of the day, I actually even have to apologize to the person and ask for forgiveness and give a hug, like Stanley says, we fell with the people, but then we should be entitled to say, I'm sorry, I failed at this and that. But as I said then, eventually, due to the lack of testimony, many of us, we carry a book of lack of testimony. And sometimes we are concerned with our position, we are concerned with our reputation, we are concerned with the way the people look at us, but we forgot that if there is some kind of reputation, we are the ones that build a reputation that in Christianity ends up to not being a reputation, but a testimony. And the testimony then, the testimony follows us as the reputation follows us. And the only reason I'm replacing the reputation by testimony is that it's because reputation is a social thing. It's a worldly thing. It's something that the society demands from you. You have to have a reputation. The model of a man, it's the best car ever. It's a very good house. It's the kids, all of them in the university. It's that special place in summer that they need to go to travel and this and that. That is the reputation of a man in the society. Then many of those men, maybe they beat the wife. They don't give the right attention to their children. They don't spend the right time with their children and this and that. And many other problems are behind that. But the model or the reputation is mounted in order for the society to see. It becomes something that is external and not internal. And a testimony, it's something that is internal. A testimony, it's something that is within you. And it's something that then it shows outside, but starts within you. That's the testimony. It's a statement of faith that you carry in your heart in the daily basis. Doesn't have nothing to do of you to fight, to have, or to create a good image. And in the church, eventually, it established in many people that they already, they established this thing of they want to show that they have a certain reputation or a certain level in life. And let me tell you something that is non-biblical, because more important than your reputation or what you look like, more important is your testimony. That's why I'm hitting the key of Jesus when he says, "Who the people say that I am?" And what about you guys? Who do you say that I am? Again, I say, he wasn't unsafe with his identity. He wasn't insecure that now I need to hear from people, as we are many times, that then we need to hear from people what they think about us, or what they think about me, and what they say about me. But that is the fruit of our insecurities. But Jesus needed to know who are the group of people that is leading to take the gospel further. That's why he needed to know. He needed to know if I can count on you. And in order for me to count on you, I needed to know, what do you think about me? What do you say? I need you to understand that the society, they say this and this about me, and you guys know it, but I need you to understand that, I know now that you know who I am. As John the Baptist is the Lamb of God that comes and takes out the sin out of this world. John the Baptist saw Jesus, he knew who he was. Finish, as I preach in the discipleship. So Jesus makes these statements in order for us to understand who he is. It's not because he's unsafe or so. The Bible says in the book of Psalms, chapter 34, verse 8, "Oh, taste and see that the Lord is good. Blessed is the man who takes refuge in him." It's a very short verse, but I read like this because we're gonna explore this verse in 4 points. "Oh, taste and see that the Lord is good. Blessed is the man who takes refuge in him." First point, the invitation. There is an invitation here. Oh, taste and see. It's the calling. He's not saying, come to the church and buy the best Bible you can ever have, because that will display that you are very spiritual. Buy a Bible and write in the Bible your name in the pages. And write as much as you can in the Bible, because that will display that you read a lot the Bible, that you read the Bible a lot. You are always reading the Bible. He's not saying that. He's saying, taste and see. He's saying, experiment God, and you need to be able to see. Experiment like you taste an apple, like you taste a good food, like you taste a Coca-Cola, like you taste whatever that you taste and you never ate. Like a few days ago, I took somebody that never went to McDonald's. I took somebody to McDonald's and then I said taste, and you taste, yeah, this is very good. This actually, but now you taste and now you saw that it's good because you tasted. So it's an invitation, and life with God is about invitations. Life with God is about prepositions. God continually does invitations, daily invitations. I could write a lot about invitations. I could have here 8, 9, 10 points, and all of them quoting different biblical verses with invitations. And for those that read the Bible and know the Bible, they know that is the truth. The Bible is full of invitations. God calling the people and make invitations. So this is one very clear, very short, but very productive. Taste and see. Experiment me and see. Have a look. You will understand after you see. So it's not an invitation to come to church. Evangelism is good when we evangelize to bring the people to Jesus, not to bring the people to church. A ministry, either evangelical, Catholic, Witness Jehovah, whatever you call, but let's stick with Christianity, either evangelical, Catholic, that we do invitations to people to come to church, that's totally wrong. We need to invite the people to come to Jesus, to receive Jesus as their Lord and Savior. The result of coming to church must be the effect of the receiving Jesus in the heart as heart and Savior. But we swap the equation, and what it's all about is that it apparently the fact that I'm in the church, I sing a few choirs, I raise my hands, I read the Bible, even in the church, that makes me a Christian. Totally wrong. It makes you a Christian when you taste and when you see. The result of seeing is what? Is a, again, a testimony. When you taste and you see, that will result in a testimony. Testimony, you know, we don't build up a testimony in 10 minutes or 5 minutes or 1 month or 2 months or 3 months. You destroy a testimony in 1 minute, in 2 minutes, 3 minutes. You do destroy, but you don't build a testimony in 1 month, 2 months, 3 months, 4 months, 5 months, a year. You don't. It takes time. When I was on sales, I discovered something. I was selling with a person that every time, then the person starts having the same speech as me when you sell and you say that we are helping drug addicts, alcoholics, and so and so. And the person taking off, using my testimony, the person will say, oh, I'm in this ministry for a year and I'm clean for a year. But then I found that it doesn't have the same effect when I open my mouth and say, I'm in this ministry for this much time and I have 14 years clean of drugs. That it creates another totally different impact. It's always was the thing of, what? Really? 14 or 15? Really? That's so long. As much years you have, people suddenly out of the blue, it becomes totally different. Hold, taste, and see, invitation. Second point, the calling. A calling. The Lord is good. Taste and see that the Lord is good. The calling is to understand that the Lord is good. Every time that we complain, like I said yesterday, last night in the night vigil, every time we complain, every time we are not able to see God, every time that we curse, we are cursing God Himself. Every time that in our understanding our life is not right, you are complaining against God. Because He should be or is the author of your life, the author of our faith. This is what the Bible says. So it is a calling to understand that the Lord is good. But for that, again, you need to go back words and say, okay, but for me to understand that the Lord is good, I need to taste and I need to see. After that, I know that the Lord is good. And when I know that the Lord is good, anything bad that comes to my life, I won't complain. I will see with the different points of view. Or even if I complain, I will be able to move back and say, you know what, I'm sorry, God, I wasn't watching or looking with the right eyes, with the right vision, so I'm sorry, give me another chance. Because we are entitled to fail. I was saying to somebody a few years ago that we are entitled to fail. People, we shouldn't put burdens. I'm a bit tired with that, especially because of my position. The people, it looks like that they want to put a burden in my shoulders. Like, suddenly out of the blue, I'm no longer human. I have to be a kind of an angel or a kind of a small god, something like that. Or God, nah. I am a human. First, then everything else, I am a human being. I'm entitled to fail too. I cannot hide behind that, as you cannot, but we are entitled to fail. We will fail. And because of that, Jesus went to the cross of the Calvary. He went because of that. He went because He knows that we messed up. He went because we know that there is no way. The Ten Commandments, well, they weren't working because they were failing the Ten Commandments all along. The people of Israel, the people of God, they were failing the Ten Commandments. It wasn't working at all. So they needed a holy sacrifice, a unique sacrifice, a spiritual sacrifice, pure and that could stand for the eternity. That was what? Jesus Christ. It could no longer be a dove. It could no longer, you know, if we could tell a joke out of this, we could say, maybe God saw that they were running out of lambs and doves. We could say a joke about that. And then they need a unique sacrifice. The sacrifice that was the Lamb of God, Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. The point three is the protection. The protection because say, all taste and see that the Lord is good, and then says, blessed is the man. Blessed. Blessed is the man. There is a blessing in it. But we also have the tendency to think what? That blessing is all about the things I get, the things I touch, the things I see. That is a blessing. I'm waiting for my blessings. I hear many people in the ministry speaking about that. I'm waiting for my blessings. But there is other blessings that we have. Did you ever thought about your soberness as a blessing? Did you ever thought about your soberness as a blessing? Did you ever thought about your family that the fact that you are in a place like this, in many cases, they are more happy than ever? Not because you are far, but because you are fine. That is a blessing already by itself. Did you thought about that? But if by any chance our car broke, if by any chance we have a problem, physical, visible, we are no longer blessing, but the blessing is still with us. And sometimes God wants to open our eyes to say, you do have a blessing. Our children are a blessing. In a marriage, people, our wives and our husbands, they are a blessing. They are a blessing. Even when the things are not right and they don't go according with what we think, they are a blessing. Our mother and father, they should be a blessing. The people that God placed around us, they should be a blessing for us. No matter how they are, no matter the character, the temper, no matter if sometimes we clash with each other, but they have to be a blessing. Sometimes the blessing can come even in a harsh way. People concerned with you and you think that this is harsh for me and so, but they are concerned with you. But because we have the format or the shape of what is concerned with me all about, then we forgot and we missed the point. But sometimes we are already blessed, but we are not able to see that we are blessed. Because for God, being blessed is knowing Him. For God, being blessed is being at His feet. Point four is my action. My action is who takes refuge in Him. Let's read the verse again. Oh, taste and see the Lord is good. Blessed is the man who takes refuge in Him. Blessed is the man. It's like something that is upside down. I take refuge in Him, and because of that, I am blessed. But He says, blessed is the man who takes refuge in Him. It's my action. My action is to take refuge in Him. Refuge in Him is that you no longer refuge in, for example, in the case of the people that we are here, on drugs. In alcohol, in our work, in our activities, in our ministry. Some of us, we can take refuge in our ministry. Some of us, we can take refuge in many other things. It can be a cigarette in many cases. It can be many things, but we take refuge. Even in the things we do, we can take refuge. But it says, blessed is the man who takes refuge in Him. The man that says, I no longer will refugee in nothing else unless in God. He will be my refugee. I will hide myself. Refuge is what? Is I will hide myself. But isn't that a sign of weakness? For the society, it's a sign of weakness. Karl Marx used to say that the religion is the opium of the people, or the heroin of the people. In other words, is the weak people. He used to say that the weak people are the ones, or are those that they turn to God, they go to God. But we know that's not a sign of weakness, because we know that the Bible also states that in order for us to be strong, we need to admit our weakness. The Apostle Paul used to say that is the recognition of his weakness, the recognition of his need. When he asks God to take the thorn in the flesh, he actually recognized that. Because God tells him that. God tells, my grace is enough for you as my power perfects in your weaknesses. It's when you raise your hand and say, I am weak on this area, on that area, and I need help, as the brother was saying. Many people forget. I understand what Stanley says, because I entered the same position. Maybe many people, they might forget that I'm also in the process of transformation and healing. And God has to deal with me too. Yeah. It's not just for you. But so where is the difference between me and you? It's that I'm in the ministry. No, it's the persistence maybe, but not that I'm in the ministry. So what's the difference? Is because I'm a pastor and you're not? No. What's the difference? So, what's the difference? It has to have a difference. The difference is the choices we make. The difference is the way we answer to the transformation and healing of God. That is the difference. Not some that just throw the towel. Yesterday came a brother here that was here with us. And it's the second time I did this. And today, eventually, he will come. I already advised with Stanley, Stanley, can we accept this man without COVID test? Because he's a brother, he belongs to the family. He said, I think so. I said, yeah, I'm asking you because I cannot decide this slightly or by myself only. I have to decide with the community. And if everybody agrees, he will be back on board. But the fact states, does he need to go? Knowing that I told him that you are not ready, there is a lot of work to do in your life, God needs to do a lot of stuff. Does he need to go to come back now like a toothpick? And it was almost looking like Ezra, that is not a big guy, it's strong. But does he need to go through the process that now he comes back as a toothpick? What he was warned about, and the second time he was warned about, don't do this, you're going to bust yourself, you're going to destroy yourself. Do you need to do this? You need it, and guess what? I'm telling you now, he will come back, and eventually, he will go away. And he will go away, and he will mess back again. Because there is people, unfortunately, that they accept their conditions so much that they even enjoy it. I'm sorry, I conclude that already. This thing of, oh, pity, you know, pity, oh, poor you, not pity in the farm. Oh, poor you, oh, let's help the brother, oh, the sister, oh, she does need help. Yepa. There was a girl that came a few days ago, also that she came two times already, but this time she came destroyed. I knew that she will do that. She did. She was treated with all the conditions. The girls, they helped her, they were with her, and she went. Guess what? She is younger than my wife. Come on. She looks 70. The opportunity is there. The hand of God is stretched. Now what we're going to say? Oh, poor girl, poor this, poor that. No. When we are without understanding, when we are without the light, enlightenment, when we are in the darkness and we don't know more, then is when the pity enters. But let's replace the word pity by compassion. Compassion, which is when the Bible speaks about and the Spirit of Jesus moves inside of him and have compassion to the person. What it means is that Jesus was actually able to put himself in the feet of the other people. That is compassion.